الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد إن شاء الله تعالى We're going to carry on the introduction to fiqh and its historical development. Today, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to speak about the concept of at-tamadhub, following a madhab. Today we're going to speak about at-tamadhub, following a madhab. And what is the correct stance in following a madhab? Are you allowed to follow a madhab? Are you not allowed to follow a madhab? If you do follow a madhab, which one should you follow? And etc. The questions that people may ask, I hope to answer it inshallah ta'ala in this session. First thing that we have to all agree upon is our religion, it stands on ala aslaini. It stands on two foundations. Our religion, it stands on two great foundations. Without it, your religion goes. The first of them is تجريد التوحيد لله تعالى. To single Allah in oneness. To single Allah in ibadah. And the second foundation in which it stands on is الاتباع للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم and following the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. So our religion, it stands on those two foundations. The first one is تجريد التوحيد لله تعالى, that you only worship Allah عز وجل, you don't associate partners with Him. And the second thing is الاتباع, to follow the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام. That is what the religion revolves around. And the textual evidences, meaning the Qur'an and the Sunnah, because of these two, it divided the people into two. Because of those two foundations, the people broke into two. Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'a, those who hold on to the two principles that we mentioned. And so they are the guided people. They are referred to as what? As Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'a. And the opposite of them is Ahlul Bid'ati wal Furqah, the people of innovation, who didn't come with those two fundamental principles that our religion stands on. So Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah became what? They became the ones known to do what? They became the ones who was found in them تجريد التوحيد لله تعالى واتباع للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. To single Allah in worship and to follow the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. And so because of that, Ahlul Sunnah, they gave precedence to the Kitab and the Sunnah. Over every speech, every opinion, every analogy, every political stances, every senses, and every rational observation. They gave the Qur'an and the Sunnah precedence over that. And the evidence in which they followed in this regard is the statement of Allah Azza wa Jalla, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ فَإِنْ تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ ذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ وَأَحْسَنُ تَأْوِيلًا. They followed that verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, O those of you who believe, obey Allah and obey the Messenger. وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ, and obey those who have authority over you. If you look at that verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, those of you who believe, أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ, obey Allah. وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولَ and obey the messenger. Ponder here. Obey Allah and obey the what? Why was the obedience repeated twice? Obey Allah and obey the Prophet. But when it came to the Ulil Amri, the word obedience didn't come. Because Allah and His Messenger are obeyed unrestrictedly. Whereas wa ulil amri minkum, they are only obeyed as long as they are in what? In line with Allah and His Messenger. And the ulul amri minkum here are those who have authority over you as the leaders and the scholars. And the scholars. So the scholars are obeyed when they are what? When they're in line with Allah and His Messenger. And then Allah says, فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ if you dispute one another, difference of opinion occurs between any one of you, what should you do? فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ bring it back to Allah. How do you bring it back to Allah? Bring it back to the Qur'an. And how do you bring it back to the Prophet? فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ how do you bring it to the Prophet after he died? You bring it back to his, you bring it back to his sunnah, as Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah mentioned. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also said in the ayah, اتبعوا ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم ولا تتبعوا من دونه أولياء قليلا ما تذكرون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, اتبعوا follow ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم, that which has come to you from your Lord. ولا تتبعوا and do not follow من دونه besides Allah, أولياء, righteous people. Don't follow them. Follow Allah and His Messenger. Meaning if they go against that which Allah and His Messenger say. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also said, Ya أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, those of you who believe, don't put anyone's speech before Allah and His Messenger. لَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ تُقَدِّمُوا, what does it mean? Don't put anything before Allah and His Messenger. And then Allah says, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ, be conscious of Allah and fear Him in doing this. Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He said, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ, let those be cautious. فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ, those who are opposing Allah and His Messenger's way, let them be cautious. What should they be cautious of? فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَن تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةً أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. They will go through fitna, or they will go through what? A severe punishment. Later, inshallah ta'ala, we will see what is meant by fitna, and what the scholars explained to be fitna. Those ayat, what does it show us, and what does it benefit us? To follow the Qur'an and the sunnah. Al-Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim narrated من حديث أبي هريرة, the hadith of Abu Huraira, اقتتلت امرأتان, two women fought one another, and they were from the tribe of Hudayl. They were from the tribe of Hudayl, meaning they threw something at each other, a rock, and one of the women died, and that woman was pregnant, and when she died, so did the child in her womb die as well. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he commanded, he judged that the woman, of course there's blood money, and also for the child, there's a blood money. So a companion, he said to the Prophet, he said, his name was Haml ibn Nabigha, after the Prophet gave a judgment, he said, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, كيف أغرم من لا شرب ولا أكل ولا نطق ولا استهل. How am I going to give blood money to a child that hasn't drunk, he hasn't had any water, nor has he eaten food, nor has he spoken? It's more appropriate that child is thrown and I don't have to pay blood money for it. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, إِنَّمَا هَذَا مِنْ إِخْوَانِ الْكُهَانِ, this man is from the brothers of the soothsayers. And the reason why he said that is because مِنْ أَجْلِ سَجْعِهِ الَّذِي سَجَعَ, because of how he tried to make his speech rhyme in opposing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Prophet didn't allow anyone to oppose his speech, alayhi salatu wasalam. And the Sahabas, they took that on board. They took that on board. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he commanded the people, بِالتَّمَتُّعِ فِي الْحَجِّ. He commanded the people, حَجُّ التَّمَتُّعِ. Hajj has types. And one of the types of Hajj is called Hajj al-Tamattu'. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he commanded the people to do Hajj al-Tamattu'. So a person stood up and he opposed Abdullah ibn Abbas. He went against Abdullah ibn Abbas. And he said to him, he said to Ibn Abbas, إِنَّ أَبَا بَكْرٍ وَعُمَرَ Abu Bakr and Umar كَانَا يَنْهَيَانِ They used to prohibit both of them عن حج التمتع. Both of them were against حج التمتع. فقال Abdullah ibn Abbas, and then he said, أَرَاهُمْ سَيَهْلِكُونَ I see these people are going to be destroyed. Ibn Abbas is saying this. I see that you people will be destroyed. أقول I say to you, قال رسول الله I say to you, the Prophet said, ويقول and then one of you would say to me, نهى أبو بكر وعمر Abu Bakr and Umar prohibited. Meaning, are you going to go against that which the Prophet said with the statement of who? Al-Shaykhan, the best of this Ummah after the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, Abu Bakr and Umar. Abdullah ibn Umar, the same thing. He would command Hajj al-Tamattu' and they came up to him and they said to him, your father, Umar radiallahu anhu, he doesn't allow it. And then he said to them, أَفَ كِتَابُ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ أَحَقُّ أَن يُتَّبَعَ أَمْ عُمَرَ Is my father more deserving to be followed or the kitab of Allah Azza wa Jalla? Because in the Quran, what did Allah say? فَمَنْ تَمَتَّعَ بِالْعُمْرَةِ إِلَى الْحَجِّ فَمَا اسْتَيْسَرَ مِنَ الْهَدِي So are we going to follow my father Umar? Or are we going to follow the book of Allah Azza wa Jalla? Al-Imam al-Bayhaqi narrated in his Sunan al-Kubra. Ubaidah ibn Samit radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he prohibited, based on the Prophet's prohibition, dirhamayni bi dirham, two dirhams to be exchanged for one dirham. Because that is money that you cannot do that for, you can't. This is aynul riba, it becomes riba, right? Gold, you cannot change silver the same. So he said, anna nabiyya, Ubaidah ibn Samit, he said that the Prophet prohibited dirhamayni bi dirham, two dirhams to be given for one dirham. The Prophet prohibited this. فَقَالَ رَجُلٌ A man stood up and then he said, مَا أَرَى بِهَذَا بَأْسًا I don't see a problem in this. What's the problem? If two parties are both happy with it, what is the problem? And then Ubaidah ibn Samit, he said, أَقُولُ قَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ I am saying to you, the Prophet said, وَتَقُولُ And then you come and you respond to me by saying, لا أرى به بأسا I see no problem with it والله لا يذلني وإياك سقف أبدا والله me and you will never come under the same roof again get out of my face والله no roof will shade both of us together get out of my face الإمام الدارمي narrated this in his Sunan so the Salaf were like that صحابة رسول الله when it came to تعظيم النصوص venerating, glorifying the text over everybody. ولذلك أبي سلمة he narrated that Abu Huraira رضي الله تعالى عنه he said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said الوضوء مما مست النار that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم he said to do wudu from the thing that the fire that went through the fire to do wudu from whatever is cooked on the fire he mentioned this hadith Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, a noble companion, he said, Ya Aba Huraira. Abdullah ibn Abbas said to Abu Huraira, Anatawadda'u min al-duhni, Anatawadda'u min al-hamimi, should we do wudu from hot water? Because you said anything that goes through water, we have to do wudu from. Does that mean we have to do wudu from water? Hot water. Trying to oppose what the Prophet said, right? So he said, Abu Huraira then said to him, Ya ibn Akhi, إذا سمعت حديثا من رسول الله ibn Abbas, if you hear a hadith from the Prophet of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَلَا تَضْرِبُوا لِلَّهِ الْأَمْثَالِ. Don't give Allah a parable. Don't give Allah an example. And Imam al-Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah narrated this, and Sheikh Nasir authenticated in Sahih Ibn Majah. Ibn Sirin, Qatada narrated, he said, حَدَّثَ ابْنُ سِيرِينَ, Muhammad ibn Sirin, he narrated from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَقَالَ رَجُلٌ, a man stood up and he said, قَالَ فُلَانٌ كَذَا وَكَذَا. After he narrated what the Prophet said, a man stood up and said, but so-and-so said this, and so-and-so said this. And Ibn Sirin said, أُحَدِّثُكَ عَنِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمَ, I am telling you what the Prophet said. وَتَقُولُ قَالَ فُلَانٌ وَفُلَانٌ, and you're telling me what so-and-so said. لَا أُكَلِّمُكَ أَبَدًا, I'm never going to speak to you. And Muhammad ibn Sirin, from that day onwards, never spoke to that man. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he then said, in his Majmu' al-Fatawa, he said, مِنْ أَعْظَمِ مَا أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ, one of the greatest things Allah blessed, meaning al-Sunnah, is i'tisamu bil kitab wa sunnah, how they hold on to the kitab and the sunnah. فَكَانَ مِنَ الْأُصُولِ الْمُتَّفَقِ عَلَيْهَا بَيْنَ الصَّحَابَةِ وَالتَّابِعِينَ لَهُمْ بِإِحْسَانِ. One of the things that the companions and the students of the companions all agreed upon, which was أَلَّا يُقْبَلُ, that it's not accepted. أَنَّهُ لَا يُقْبَلُ مِنْ أَحَدٍ قَطُّ أَنْ يُعَارِضَ الْقُرْآنَ لَا بِرَأِيهِ وَلَا ذَوْقِهِ وَلَا مَعْقُولِهِ وَلَا قِيَاسِهِ وَلَا وَجْدِهِ. That anyone can go against the Quran and the Sunnah with his logic, with whatever he thinks, his opinions, with his analogy, and etc. This is something they all agreed upon. Here the question is, can I oppose the Quran and the Sunnah based on a statement of an imam? I follow a madhab, so my madhab says this. Can I? Let's look at what the Salaf were in regards to this issue and how they saw it. Al-Imam al-Tirmidhi in his Sunan, Al-Imam al-Tirmidhi, he mentions in his Sunan, he says, وَسَمِعْتُ أَبَا سَائِبٍ, I heard Abu Sa'ibin say, he mentions this, يَقُولُ سَيِّن, كُنَّا عِنْدَ وَكِيعٍ, we were with Waki' ibn Jarrah al-Ru'asi, فَقَالَ لِرَجُلٍ عِنْدَهُ مِمَّنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَى الرَّأِيِ, أَمَّا مِمَّنْ يَنْظُرُ فِي الرَّأِيِ. Waki' said to a man who used to look into opinions, and Ahlul Ra'yi was a madrasa, which we'll speak about later when we speak about the madhab of Al-Imam Abu Hanifa and others. Anyways, Waki' mentioned the permissibility of Ish'ar al-Budm, to place a mark on the Budn. Budn is the animal that's going to be slaughtered for the Hadi in Hajj, to place a mark on it. So when he mentioned that this is a sunnah from the Prophet of Allah, Nabi Muhammad, Waki', a man stood up and he said, Ibrahim al-Nakha'i, who's a tabi'i, Jalil, a noble tabi'i, he said, Al-Ish'aru Muthlah, to make a mark on an animal is mutilation. Mutilation for the animal is not allowed. You can't cut an animal's nose and ears. You can't mutilate an animal. So placing a mark on it, it falls under mutilation, is not permissible. Waki' and Abu Sa'ibin, he said, فَرَأَيْتُ وَكِيعًا غَضِبَ غَضْبًا شَدِيدًا. Waki' became excessively angry. And then he said, أَقُولُ لَكَ, I am saying to you, قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, the messenger said, وَتَقُولُ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ, and you're telling me Ibrahim al-Nakha'i said, مَا أَحَقَّكَ, your rights, what you deserve right now is, بأن تحبس, that you get imprisoned, you get put behind bars. ثم لا تخرج, and then you do not come out from prison, حتى ينزع عن قولك هذا, unless you come back from what you just said. That's how harsh they were. Listen to this. This is the most shocking thing that you come across. Ibn Abi Dhi'bin, something he said about Imam Malik. Who's Imam Malik? Imam Malik is Imam Dar al-Hijra. Imam Malik, Sahib al-Muwatta. Al-Imam Malik is al-Najmu, he's a star in Sunnah. Sahih? Al-Imam Malik, when it came to Majlis al-Khiyar, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, he said, al-Bay'ani, that the two transactions of the two people is based upon bil-Khiyari, ma'lam yatafarraqa, as long as they don't depart from one another. Sah? When two people buy from one another, they have time which they can come back from their view and say, you know what, give me back my money, I don't want the product. The person has a what? That majlis. Imam Malik, this hadith, he didn't accept it. And of course he has his own interpretation and his own reasons, okay? Lakin Ibn Abi Dhibin said something very powerful. When he was told, and Imam al-Dhahabi mentioned in his Sir Alam al-Nubala, let me read it. قال أحمد بن حنبل بلغ ابن أبي ذئب. It reached Ibn Abi Dhibb, a great Imam who is equivalent to Imam Malik or close to Imam Malik. أن مالك لم يأخذ بحديثي, that Imam Malik did not take the hadith البيعان بالخيار. He didn't take this hadith, Imam Malik. فقال ابن أبي ذئب, he said يستتاب. Malik is told to repent. فإن تاب, if he repents, then that's good. وإلا ضرب عنقه, except or else Imam Malik is killed. Or else, and Imam Malik is killed for that, for going against the Prophet's hadith. That's Imam Malik. Look what Imam Ahmed said straight after that. And Imam al-Dhahabi mentions in his Sirah Alam al-Nubala, he said, Ahmed ibn Hanbal, he said, هو أروع وأقوى بالحق من مالك. Ibn Abi Dhi'b is right in this issue. He has more wara and he's more safer in this issue than Imam Malik. But Imam al-Dhahabi didn't like that. And he said, if Ibn Abi Dhi'b had wara, كما ينبغي, as it was, لما قال هذا الكلام القبيح في حق إمام عظيم. He would never have said something filthy like that regarding a great Imam such as, you know, Imam al-Dhahabi, when you read his Seerah Alam al-Nubala, sometimes he gets angry of some people's statements that they say. And he gives a ta'qib. He says, if Ibn Abi Dhibb is a person who is righteous and he has wara in his statement, then he wouldn't have said this about Imam Malik. Ala kulli hal, the point I want to get from this story is how they were strong and harsh and tough in the issue of following the Nusus al-Wahyayn and the fact that you're not allowed to go against the Kitab and the Sunnah for whatever opinion that you think is out there if it goes against the Quran and the Sunnah. Here the question is, brothers, now this is the golden question, which is, some people, it seems as though when they look at all of those statements and when they look at those evidences that I brought, that it only refers to the people of knowledge and not the ignorant ones. That the ayah that I mentioned, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةً أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. أما the ayah, اتَّبِعُوا مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكُمْ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا مِنْ دُونِي أَوْلِيَاءَ قَلِيلًا مَا تَذَكَّرُونَ. يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تقدموا بين يدي الله ورسوله واتقوا الله إن الله سميع عليم. The ayah, يا أيها الذين آمنوا أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول وأولي الأمر منكم فإن تنازعتم في شيء فردوه إلى الله والرسول إن كنتم تؤمنون بالله واليوم الآخر ذلك خير وأحسن تأويلا. Those verses and many other verses, they look at it as though it's only for the scholars and that the عامة الناس, they are not being spoken to here. And that's incorrect. Everybody should follow the Quran and the Sunnah. كَائِنًا مَنْ كَانَ, whoever that person may be, whether he's a person who has no knowledge or whether he's a person who has great knowledge. Everybody has to follow the Quran and the Sunnah. But the way that everyone has to follow it is different, لا شك. And that needs tafsil, which we'll come to. Here there's an important, another second question, which is, some people, when it comes to those evidences that I brought, they look at it as though it's only referring to issues which are aqidah, masail which are qat'i, clear-cut issues, and that it's not referring to fiqh issues. Meaning the Quran and the Sunnah is not really followed in fiqh issues. You can follow the qawl of a madhab and an imam and what he said. And that dalil has to only be followed in issues of what? Aqidah. That's as though some people's statement, or that's how they come across what they say. Sahih? Correct? And that's not true. Because all of those evidences is referring to what? Al-masail al-ilmiyyah and also al-masail al-amaliyyah. Aqeedah and fiqh, both. And the salaf, if you really look at them, you actually find when it comes to these issues of following the Quran and the Sunnah, the overwhelming majority of times, they were referring to a people who went against the fiqh issue, not actually an aqidah issue. Are we all together, brothers? If you go and read the great noble book, I'lam al-Muwaqqi'in, written by Ibn al-Qayyim, you actually find that the majority of the times, the things that were spoken about were fiqh issues, which they were staunch and tough on, not necessarily aqidah issues. Here I want to mention some statements of the Salaf in this issue. And Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, he said something very powerful. He said, "Ajibtu liqawmin," I am fascinated with the people. Who's saying this? And Imam Ahmad is saying, "Ajibtu liqawmin," I am fascinated with the people. "Araful isnada," they know the chain. "Wasihatahu," and they know its authenticity, whether it's sahih or da'if, they know it. "Yadhabuna," and then they go, "ila ra'yi Sufyan," then they go and they take this view of Sufyan al-Thawri. They know the chain, they know the hadith, they know its authenticity, they know it, and then they leave that. And they go to whose view? They go to Sufyan al-Thawri rahimahullahu ta'ala. And then he recited the ayah, "فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةً أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ." And Imam Ahmad, look what he said, "أَتَدْرِي مَا الْفِتْنَةِ?" Do you know what the fitna is? الْفِتْنَةُ الشِّرْكِ. The fitna here is shirk. How is it shirk? Because لَعَلَّهُ إِذَا رَدَّ بَعْضُ قَوْلِهِ أَنْ يَقَعَ فِي قَلْبِهِ شَيْءٌ مِنَ الزَّيْغِ فَيَهْلِكَ. Because remember, when you reject one issue, one dalil, if you reject it, you're going to reject 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 100, and you're going to go. And then you're going to come out with the view that we should only take the Quran. And then after that, you just walk away from the religion. And that's how it starts. Rejecting one evidence. Turning away from one evidence. So don't belittle one dalil. وَلِذَلِكَ, the person who wants the haqq, he will take one evidence if it's brought to him, and that's enough for him. One evidence is enough for him. The same way, he won't go against one evidence. Here, another point that we want to go into, these madhahib al-fiqhiyya that we see, madhab al-imam Abu Hanifa, madhab al-imam Malik rahimahullah, al-imam al-Shafi'i, and al-imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahimahullah. These madhahibs, and if we add a fifth one, which we're going to mention, inshallah ta'ala, madhab al-zahiriyya. I'm going to speak about these five madhabs. And we do believe that there are five madhabs. Some scholars don't believe that. And it's a khilaf whether this fifth one can be counted or not. But that's a side point. These five madhahibs, they came about. But they came after al-qurun al-ula al-mufaddala. They came after that. They spread after, this is where these madhabs came. The students of these imams spread their madhabs. And they're the ones who combined it. They're the ones who collected it. They're the ones who then looked into it and brought principles out of it. وَمَا إِلَى ذَلِكَ. And then they became the four madhabs, the five madhabs that are followed. There were other madhabs. There were other madhabs, such as Sufyan al-Thawri rahimahullah, he had a madhab. And al-Imam al-Awza'i, he had a madhab. Al-Layth ibn Sa'ad had a madhab. Ishaq ibn Rahuyah had a madhab. Abu Thawr had a madhab. These are madhabs that existed. Lakin in darasa, it perished. And it went. وَلَمْ يَمْتَدَّ, and it didn't spread like these four madhabs spread. These four madhabs, they spread until today we see them. But the question is, just because these four madhabs are present till today, from that time till now, does it mean that the haqq is in these four madhabs? Does it mean that because the other madhabs went, that's an indication and an evidence that the haqq is restricted to these four imams, al-Imam Abu Hanifa, and al-Imam Malik, Shafi'i and Ahmed, and that the haqq is not outside this? Is that what it means? Does it mean that these madhabs are hujjah, a proof that we should follow? Does it show that we have to follow these madhabs? And does it also show any other madhab other than these four are weak? Is that what it shows? No. It doesn't. And there's something I want you to all memorize, inshallah ta'ala, which is, these madhabs spreading and staying till today is amrun kawniyun la shar'iyun. It's a universal issue, and it's not a legislational issue. It's a universal thing. It's from Allah's way of doing things. Allah has a sunnah, a way that He does things, subhanahu wa ta'ala, a path in which He does things, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so these four madhabs spreading is a universal issue. And you're not allowed to use a universal issue to make it a legislational matter. Ihfadu, memorize this point. You are not allowed to use a universal issue and say that because universally this happened, it must be this shara'an. I'll give you an example. Somebody can say, I went to the grave so-and-so and I asked him for a child. I've been asking it for 10 years and Allah gave me a child. So that means it's permissible for me to ask the dead. What did he use? He used the universe. Something happened for him. And so this universal thing is making him say what? The permissibility of this issue. And that's something we should stay away from. Yes, you can use a universal sign to prove a textual evidence, to strengthen a textual evidence. There's a delil in this issue, and then you're trying to prove a universal sign to support it. Are we all together? Such as Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He destroys the oppressors. And then you bring an example and you say, look at these oppressors, Allah destroyed them. وَمَا إِلَى ذَلِكَ. That's permissible. But to make the ruling for something which has no textual evidence, but your evidence here is a universal evidence, this is not correct. Does that make sense? Does everyone understand that point? That's very important that we understand it. So the question here is, why did these four madhabs spread and not the rest? The reason why these four madhabs spread is because they venerated and glorified the textual evidence, the Quran and the Sunnah. That doesn't mean the other imams didn't. But these four imams, they stuck by the textual evidence, the Quran and the Sunnah. And they honored it and they glorified it. And because of that, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala allowed their statements and their views to spread. Not because they are infallible and they're free from mistakes. That's not why it spread. And that's not why it continued. That is not why it continued. Let me give you some examples of how they respected and honored and venerating their textual evidences. Ibn al-Qayyim said, وَقَدْ نَهَى الْأَئِمَّةُ الْأَرْبَعَةُ عَنْ تَقْلِيدِهِمْ. The four imams, Abu Hanifa, Malik, Shafi'i, and Ahmed, four of the imams, all of them prohibited to be blind followed. All four of them said, no one should blind follow us. وَذَمُّوا, and they rebuked, مَنْ أَخَذَ أَقْوَالَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حُجَّةٍ. And all four of them rebuked anyone who took their statements without any proof. They rebuked that. How dare you do that? The four imams did that. Ibn Hazm, he said in his kitab Al-Ihkam, في أصول الأحكام, وَقَدْ ذَكَرْنَا أَنَّ مَالِكًا وَأَبَا حَنِيفَةَ والشافعية لم يقلدوا ولا أجازوا لأحد أن يقلدوهم ولا أن يقلد غيرهم. مالك, أبو حنيفة, شافعي, they did not blind follow anyone. ولا أجازوا, nor did they allow anyone to blind follow them. And they also didn't allow anyone to blind follow anyone else. ولذلك they said, لا يحل لأحد, it is not permissible for anyone, أن يأخذ بقولنا, to take our statements, ما لم يعلم من أين أخذناه, if he doesn't know where we took it from. No one should take our statements if he doesn't know where we took it from. Ibn Abd al-Barr mentions in his kitab الانتقاء that they said, لا يحل لمن يفتي من كتب أن يفتي حتى يعلم من أين قلت. It is not permissible for anybody to give a fatwa from my book until he knows where I took it from. and why I said it, and what was my reason behind it. Al-Imam Malik, he said, إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ. Al-Imam Malik is saying this. I am a human being. أُخْطِئُ, I get it wrong. وَأُصِيبُ, and I get it right. فَانْظُرُوا فِي رَأِي, look at my opinion. فَكُلُّ مَا وَافَقَ الْكِتَابَ وَالسُّنَّةِ, everything that is in line with the kitab and the sunnah, فَخُذُوهُ, take it. وَكُلُّ مَا لَمْ يُوَافِقْ, and everything that is not in line with the kitab and the sunnah, and is not in agreement with the kitab and the sunnah, فَتُرُكُوهُ, leave it, abandon it. Ibn Abdul Bar mentions that in his kitab, جَامِعُ بَيَانِ الْعِلْمِ وَفَضْلِهِ. And Imam Shafi'i, he said, a statement that deserves to be written in ink of gold. He said, أَجْمَعَ الْمُسْلِمُونَ, the Muslims are unanimously in agreement. على أن من استبانت له سنة عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, that anyone who the Quran and the Sunnah becomes clear to him, this is ijma', there's no khilaf. Anyone who the Quran and the Sunnah becomes clear to him, أن من استبانت له سنة عن رسول الله لم يكن له, it is not permissible for him after the Quran has become clear to you and the Sunnah became clear to you, after that it is not permissible for you. أن يدعها لقول أحد من الناس, you cannot leave it for the speech of anyone. كائنا من كان, whoever that person is, however high he is, even if it's Abu Bakr and Umar, if the Quran and the Sunnah said something and it becomes clear to you, you can't leave it for the statement of anyone. They also said, إذا صح الحديث عن رسول الله فخذوا به ودعوا قولي, if a hadith is authentically transmitted from the Prophet, then take it and leave our speech and our statement. Ibn Hazm, he mentioned بسنده, with his chain, عن المازني, that Al-Imam Shafi'i, he prohibited, أنه نهى عن تقليده وتقليد غيره. Shafi'i said to his students, don't blind follow me and don't blind follow anyone else. Don't. ولذلك Al-Imam Suyuti has a kitab called الرد على من أخلد إلى الأرض. He has a book which he refutes a people who said that the chapter of ijtihad, independent reasoning, is closed. You can't look at the Quran and the Sunnah, all you have to do is blind follow. He refuted them. And he brought the statement of Abu Shama. Abu Shama, he said, Naha Imamuna, our Imam prohibited us. Our Imam, he prohibited us. Ya'ni Shafi'i, an Imam Shafi'i, and taqlidi, to blind follow him. Wa taqlidi ghayrihi, and to blind follow other than him. And many other statements. Imam Ahmad, he said, لا تقلدوني ولا تقلد مالكا ولا الثوري ولا الأوزاعي خذ من حيث أخذوا. And he also said, من قلة فقه الرجل, to show you a person's fiqh is very little, they don't have good fiqh, is أن يقلد في دينه الرجال, that he blind follows men. And then he said, لا تقلد دينك أحدا, don't ever blind follow anyone. And because of that, Al-Imam Ahmad never wrote his madhab, and he never allowed his madhab to be written. Al-Imam Ahmad, Ibn al-Qayyim, look what he said. He said, وَلِأَجْلِ هَذَا لَمْ يُؤَلِّفِ الْإِمَامُ أَحْمَدُ, and because of that, Al-Imam Ahmad did not author فِي الْفِقْهِ, in fiqh, he didn't author. Al-Imam Ahmad did not write كِتَابًا فِي الْفِقْهِ, a book in fiqh. وَإِنَّمَا دَوَّنَ أَصْحَابُهُ, his students came and they authored it. They authored his madhab. مِنْ أَقْوَالِهِ وَأَفْعَالِهِ, from his speeches and his actions. وَأَجْوِبَتِهِ, and his verdicts, the answers he gave. وَغَيْرِ ذَلِكَ, and other than that. And Imam Ahmad didn't even do it. And if you look at Imam Ahmad's madhab, the scholars, they break it into three. Tabaqa, which are known as the Tabaqatu Al-Mutaqaddimin, the early generation. And that starts from Al-Imam Ahmad up to Al-Qadhi Abu Ya'la. And Tabaqatu Al-Mutawassita is from Al-Qadhi Abu Ya'la up to Ibn Muflih Al-Hafid. And from the third one is Tabaqatu Al-Mutaakhirin, the last generation. It starts from Alauddin, who died in 885, up to Al-Imam Mansur ibn Idris Al-Buhuti rahimahullah, who did the sharah of the Kitab Al-Muntaha, Muntaha Al-Iradat. So even if you look at Madhab Imam Ahmad today, that many people are studying today, well, as if it's shadeed, just to show you something. Today the Madhab Imam Ahmad that you're studying, it goes back to Tabaqatul Mutaakhirin. No one really goes but to the level high. They stick with the last level, which is the level of who? Alauddin ibn Sulaiman. They stick with his aqwal. And then Ibn Najjar and Hajjaj, they rarely go back to the kalam of even Hatta Muwaffaquddin ibn Qudama, who authored the kitab Al-Mughni and Al-Umda and Al-Kafi and Al-Muqni'. So the point I'm trying to come to, brothers, here right now is, that was a side point, is all of those a'immah were very staunch and they were very tough when it came to what? Following the Qur'an and the Sunnah, and venerating the Qur'an and the Sunnah over what? Over the speech of anybody. The Qur'an and the Sunnah should be given precedence. Now I want to mention something, because all of that looks like I'm against Madhab, right? Doesn't it look? It does. Let me come back to a point now. And this is very important, because those who teach Madhab, and this is something I would say, it's necessary that they nurture the people with the veneration of the Qur'an and the Sunnah, and the honoring of the Qur'an and the Sunnah, and the importance of following the Qur'an and the Sunnah, and that the person doesn't straight away open a book in fiqh and say, قال الإمام. First halaqa, before you start the book, he should teach the people the importance of the Qur'an and the Sunnah and how it should be followed, and that this is something that everyone should follow. He should build and place that in the hearts of the people. And then inshallah ta'ala, if he wants to teach it, then no problem. Here now I want to mention something. Kutubul Madhab, the books of Madhabs, whether it be Madhab al-Imam Abu Hanifa, al-Imam Malik, and Shafi, and Ahmed, it is a path which is easy. Kutub al-Madhab is an easy way to gain fiqh without a doubt. That is the issue. لا ينتضح في كبشان. Two goats will not headbutt one another on. It's a musallam. That kutub al-Madhahib and kutub al-Madhab, it's an easy way. أسهل طريق وأيسرها. It's the easiest and the most simplest of way to gain fiqh. But the question is it the only way to gain fiqh? No. So please distinguish these two things from one another. Those who say that you have to study a fiqh and that's the only way to understand the Quran and the Sunnah, and those who say, no, that's not the only way. There are other ways, but the best and the easiest is to study through fiqh. Do you see the difference? Some are saying, السبيل الوحيد لطلب العلم, to gain knowledge, والتفقه, and to have understanding, is through madhabs. There's no other way. And another group is saying, no, there are other ways. And we're going to show other ways that there are. Okay? There are other ways. But the easiest, the simplest, is without a doubt, no one can deny that, it is through following a madhab and going through a madhab. That is the easiest way. That is the easiest way. But here the question is, and it's a common question that is asked, هل يجب التمذهب? Following the madhab, is it wajib? Is it wajib to follow madhab? Isn't that a common question that's asked? No. No, it's not obligatory. Why? Because anyone who says it's obligatory, he's talking about hukmun shar'i. Hukm shar'i, which is taklifi. He's given a jurisprudent ruling. And the wujub, the obligation, goes back to where? Al-Quran, wa-sunnah, wa-ijma'ul ummah. The Qur'an and the Sunnah and the Ijma' can only make something obligatory. So here, following the four a'immatul arba'ah, you have to be upon a madhab. The person have to bring it from the Qur'an or the Sunnah, or they have to bring us a consensus. They have to bring us a consensus. Will they be able to bring a Qur'an in this issue? Can they? Who came first, the four Imams or the Quran and the Sunnah? So the Quran and Sunnah cannot support that. Sah? And as for ijma', then it can't be the ijma' of the Sahabas because they were after the Sahabas. Are we all together? So here the question is, the following of madhabs is not obligatory at all, but it's permissible. It's a wasila, it's a means. It's a path you can take, but it's not obligatory, it's not wajib. And those who have said that it's wajib are the muta'assibin of the usuliyin. They are people who are fanatic from the usuliyin who say that. Lakin, you will never come across a scholar who is a muhaqqiq who will say such a speech. Never. A scholar who is a muhaqqiq, mudaqqiq, will never say something like that. Will never say something like that. Another question now. Is the truth restricted to these four? It's another question, right? Which is a mas'ala the scholars speak about, which is inhisarul haqq. Is the truth restricted to these four? Meaning it doesn't leave any of those four. If Ahmad didn't say it, Shafi'i said it. If Shafi'i didn't say it, Abu Hanifa said it. If Abu Hanifa didn't say it, Malik said it. It's with one of them. To the extent that they say if these four agree with each other on an issue, it has to be a consensus and we have to follow it. Are we all together? Here the question is, this issue would need a dalil from the Qur'an and the Sunnah and the Ijma', and of course that cannot be found from the Qur'an or the Sunnah or the Ijma'. So what can they use? Those who say that the truth is restricted to the four Imams, the only thing that they could use that's left for them is universal. The universal signs. What do I mean by the universal signs? That they say scholars have come generations after generations and they've been following these four madhabs, not any other madhab. And here it takes us back to something we mentioned before, which was what? Can you use a universal sign for a shari'i ruling? Can you? Are you allowed to? Does the tatabu'ul ulama, because the scholars have followed on this issue and that they studied these books, does it show that the truth is restricted to this? No, rather opposite is true, which we'll come to later inshallah ta'ala. I'm going to prove it even more later bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. Another group of people will come and they will say these books, madhab books that we have in front of us, they have been worked on. حُرِّرَتْ وَضُبِطَتْ أُصُولُهَا وَقَوَاعِدُهَا. Its principles, its foundations have been worked on centuries, decades, and it has gone through the test of time. صح? That's what they say. We will say all that has proven is not that it's obligatory to follow it. It hasn't proven that. Nor did it prove that the truth is restricted in those four. It hasn't proven that. But the thing that it has proved for us is that these madhabs are mutakamil. That mashallah, it's complete. It's been really served. It's been taken care of. Allah has protected this imam's speech. That's all that can be said about it. But it doesn't prove that the haqq is restricted with these four. Nor does it prove that it's obligatory to follow those four. The only thing that it does prove for us is that it's easier to follow it, and that it's also a madhab that has a imams whose works have been worked on and it has been completed. Okay? But it doesn't show that you have to follow it. And sometimes these are the things that they use for you. They say to you, "Akhi, look at these madhabs. This book started from this place and it went through this and then this, and these scholars are at least a decade, 1,000 years ago before us, or they've been these many years before us, and look at these books." We'll say that these books are good and they're easy to read or to go on and to benefit from, but it doesn't show that it's obligatory to follow it, nor does it show that the truth is restricted restricted in it. Another point that I want to prove is, if you look at today, you actually find some of the majami' al-fiqhiyya, and you look at the mu'assasat al-ilmiyya, and the dur al-ifta. So in some Muslim countries, they actually give fatwa other than the four a'immatul arba'a, what they believe. Outside it. Some of the big, like Azhar, like Hayat Kibar al-Ulama, like Rabidat al-Alim al-Islami, like Majma' al-Fiqhi, some of them give fatwas in issues that are in opposition to the four madhabs, all of them. Example, talaq al-thalath, the three talaq, that it happens as one, even if the person intended three. This is against the four imams. And this is the fatwa given by some of the majami' al-fiqhiyya. So they don't believe that the truth is restricted with the four. Are we all together, brothers? This madhab is a madhab that Umar radiallahu anhu believed it, and before him, and Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah pushed it. Are we all together? Lakin Imam Abu Hanifa and Malik and Shafi and Ahmed, all four of them don't believe that. Are we all together, brothers? And this is one of the issues that Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, because of it, he went behind prison. He went to prison for it. Also the issue of musabaqatul khayl wal ibil, the racing of the horse and the camel without having to bring a third one, which is known as the muhallil. You don't bring a muhallil without it. The racing of the horses, the permissibility or not, the permissibility of the horse racing and the camel racing without a muhallil. This is not madhab of the A'immatul Arba'a. This is the view of Abu Ubaidah, and also Ibn al-Qayyim in his Kitab al-Furusiyyah. He wrote a whole book on it. Are we all together? Some majami' al-fiqhiyya give this fatwa. Are we all together, brothers? And many other issues, and many other issues like that. Another question that I want to answer before we go into these, because we're going to study Imam Abu Hanifa in great details, inshallah, in his madhab and how it came about, and Imam Malik, and Shafi'i, and Ahmed. But first of all, we have to understand these points. Is it obligatory on a student of knowledge, if he wants to study fiqh, that he goes through the madhab way? He has to study through a madhab way. And that he's prohibited from going to any other books that are not madhabs. Is that the case? No. What we have to understand is, it's whatever allows you to understand the kitab and the sunnah. This is a means. If there's any other means that will allow you to understand the Quran and the sunnah and have fiqh of it, it's permissible, and you're allowed to study it. You are allowed to study it. Like, for example, the Kitab Al-Iqna' Ibn al-Mundhir and the Kitab Al-Durar al-Bahiyya fi al-Masail al-Fiqhiyya, written by Muhammad ibn Ali Shawkani with his own sharah, Al-Durar al-Mudhiyya, and also the sharah of Siddiq Hassan Khan, which is Rawd al-Nadiyya. Can a person study those books? Because those books are not madhabs. And even Manhaj al-Salikin by Ahmad Nasir al-Sa'di, that's not Kutub al-Madhab. These books are not Kutub al-Madhab. Question here is, can a person say, I just want to do Durr al-Bahiyya, I'm going to study this book, and I don't want to go through this whole madhab process? What do we say in this situation? It's permissible. If you're going to understand the Quran and the Sunnah through it, you don't have to necessarily go through a madhab. But is it easier to go through a madhab? It's easier. It's easier to get to your goal. It's easier to attain great understanding. It's easier. But to say it's obligatory for you to go through Kutub al-Madhab, that's غير صحيح. Are we all together? And it's not permissible to do tadyiq, tighten something which is wasi', and to prohibit that which is mubah. Another issue is, if a person studies a Kutub al-Madhab, he's studying Kutub al-Madhab, he's studying it, because we said that it's good, right? It's easier, it's faster to understand fiqh, the way that they broke it down and the way they simplified it. If that's the case, is a person allowed to study a Kutub al-Madhab And if he sees an issue in it, can he go out of it? Is he allowed to go out? Or is it that he's studying this book, he has to restrict himself to this book? For example, a person is studying Matlabi Shuja' in Fiqh al-Shafi'i. Does he have to stick to this book and not go outside it? Or is he allowed to go out? The person is either one of two. If he's a mujtahid, then la shakka wa la raib, he's not allowed to. If he's a mujtahid, meaning he's reached a level to look at the Quran and the Sunnah, then it's obligatory on him to look at the Quran and the Sunnah and take what the Quran and the Sunnah says. And he's not allowed to take the statement of a person. The second person is a person who is a muqallid, let's say. A person who's a muqallid, a blind follower. The muqallid has to take from a teacher who gives him the evidence. Are we all together, brothers? And he has to take and trust his teacher. What does he do? He trusts the teacher who's teaching him. Some people, this is what I see in them. I'm teaching a kitab, Matab al-Shuja'. I, Abdulrahman, mathalan, I'm somebody else who's teaching it, will see that the matin here is wrong. Hada binisbati ilayya. I have one of two. I'm reading a kitab for you, I'm teaching you. You're studying this book with me, this Matab al-Shuja' with me. Kitab min kutub, it's a kitab min kutub madhab al-Shafi'i. I see this mas'ala is wrong. But the imam wrote it in the book. One of two paths is open for me. For me to say, let's just stick to the book. And the second one is to say, no, it's wrong. Are we all together? And correct what's in the book. The right way is that I have to correct it. Because if I leave you with something I believe is wrong, I've deceived you. And what was my responsibility? To tell you what's right from? I might be wrong, the book might be right. That's bi ghaddi an-nazar. That's besides the point. The point is, my responsibility that's placed on me is to tell what I believe to be right. When I'm explaining this book to you. Because Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he said, لَا تُبَيِّنُنَّهُ لِلنَّاسِ وَلَا تَكْتُمُونَ. You clarify the issue to the people and you do not conceal it and you don't hide it. Are we all together? مثلا المذهب الشافعي, they believe تلفظ بالنية, that you have to utter the intention. You say أصلي الظهر أربع ركعات, you have to pronounce your intention. I come across it and I look at it and I just go over it, and I know the person next to me, I teach him and I'm not telling him that what he studied or what he took is wrong. Is that correct? Is that correct for me to do that? No, it's not correct for me. I have to clarify to him what I believe is right from what I believe is wrong. As a teacher, it's your responsibility. And you have to clarify it for him. And not watch the person being upon a mistake that you know is opposite. All based on the opinion which is, he's a beginner, he will get to the point where he will understand. So you're going to watch him do wrong? You're going to watch him say, أصلي ظهر أربع ركعات and do تلفظ بالنية وما إلى ذلك, and other than that. Are we all together? So the teacher's responsibility is to clarify. The teacher may be wrong. When the student learns, he might realize that the teacher, what he said, was wrong and the matan was right. Are we all together, brothers? But the point at that moment is, you gave them what you believe to be right, and we're going to come to the mas'ala. How do we know what's rajih and what's not? We'll come to that inshaAllah ta'ala bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. Here another question that arises, which is, this person is a beginner. This person is a beginner. If you give him the evidences, or you give him what is strong from what is weak, he doesn't know how to distinguish it. He's a beginner. He's just a blind follower. How would you do that to him? This implies that the statement of the scholar is easier to understand than the Quran and the Sunnah. Huh? When you say that, you're saying that understanding the kalam of an imam is actually easier than the understanding of a what? A dalil from the Quran and the Sunnah. And later on, I'm going to bring you examples that it's a lot of the times easier to understand the qawl when a mas'ala is mentioned. Like for example, let's take the Kitab Az-Zad. Let's look at Kutub Al-Shafi'iyah as well. How much do they divide the water into? They Tahir. They say Tahirun Mutahir. And they say Tahirun Ghayrun Mutahirin. And they're Najas. No, that's not, doesn't exist. The only thing is Tahir. And there's Najas. Isn't it easier for me to tell him Qawlu Rajah? Then instead of going, putting him through this whole process of three, when one is actually not, it doesn't exist. عند التحقيق, when we go to the bottom of it. Are we all together, brothers? So it's actually easier sometimes to give the evidence and the simplicity of it. Here the question is, another question, some people will say, you have to follow the madhab. The reason is because من باب التدرج. This is the only way to understand fiqh. And since it's the easiest way, it has to be obligatory. Are we all together, brothers? Tadarruj. No, tadarruj only shows us that it's easier that way. What does it show us? It shows us that it's easier to study the madhab like this, but it doesn't show obligation. Until now, we have no evidence to say it's obligatory. Nor do we have any evidence to say that the haqq is restricted in these four imams. Are we all together, brothers? But yes, it's easier. For example, Al-Imam Ibn Qudamah's Kutubs, he wrote the Kitab Umdah. Once you finish it, you go for the Muqni'. Once you finish it, Al-Kafi. Once you finish it, you go to the Mughni. Yahya Sarsari, as Ibn Raja mentions in his Kitab, Daylu Tabaqat al-Hanabila, he brought it all together and he said, كَفَى الْخَلْقِ بِالْكَافِي وَأَقْنَعَ طَالِبًا بمقنع فقه عن كتاب مطول وأغنى بمقنع الفقه ما كان باحثا وعمدته من يعتمدها يحصلي وروضته ذات الأصول كروضة أماست بها الأزهار أنفاس شمألي تدل على المنطوق أوفى دلالة وتحمل في المفهوم أحسن محملي. He mentioned the four books. What did he mention? مقنع. Sorry, عمدة. مقنع. كافي. الكافي. And what? The مغني. Yes, it's تدرج like that. You go one after the other. And you do it like that if you want to. But it doesn't show it's obligatory. Are we all together, brothers? Kutub al-Shafi'iyah, you start from Matabi Shuja'a, you finish it. You go to Yaqut al-Nafis, you finish it. After Yaqut al-Nafis, you go to Az-Zubat ibn al-Raslan, you finish it. You go to Umdat al-Salik or Uddat al-Nasik ibn al-Naqib al-Misri, you finish it. And then you go to Minhaj by Nawawi. That's it. This helps you, la shak. But it doesn't make it obligatory and that you have to follow the madhabs. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illallah astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.